Home internet speeds are ever increasing, and the costs always seem to be getting less expensive. That is, of course, until you look at maritime internet costs. In the UK, Virgin Media has a 100 megabits per second package for £336 or $420 a year. What if I told you that same package on a superyacht would cost $733,000 or $900,000 a year? Would you believe me? And how will Elon Musk and Starlink change things, and when? Let's find out. I'm finally back in the UK. I'm in a new home studio, which is not finished, clearly, because it's just plain walls. Bear with me. I will get it decorated soon. Today, we're going to talk about all things internet on superyachts. And what do I mean by that? I mean, how does a superyacht get its internet? It's not going to be too technical, so don't worry if you're a layman. So a few years ago, I made a video on this very subject, and basically two things came of it. First of all, lots of people corrected me for saying megabytes instead of megabits. Yeah, shocking, I know. So that was a mistake on my part. Obviously, all internet providers sell in megabits per second. I might do it again by accident in this video, but I clearly mean megabits per second. The second thing that came of it is, even now, even today, I get messages, well, Elon Musk Starlink is going to resolve all these problems, it's going to be cheap for everybody, when he launches Starlink in 2020. We'll come back to that later. So any superyacht effectively has four ways to connect to the internet. Number one is 4G or cellular. Number two is Wi-Fi, offered by many marinas. Number three is a shore connection or a cable connection. And number four is VSAT, also known as satellite communications. The most often used and by far the most expensive. So a quick question, pause the video here. What does VSAT stand for? Don't Google it, just put it in the comments if you know what it is. All right, we'll come back to it later. So, okay, so we'll go through them one by one. So the first one is 4G. Obviously, 4G, everybody uses it on their phones. You know, a SIM card in your phone, you get data, and away you go. So on a yacht, it's not quite so simple. We have devices called a PepWave or a MIMO cellular device, which is like a small modem that accepts cellular SIM cards. And then from there, we run an antenna. We put an antenna on the mast. We run a cable down to this device, and then we connect this device to the ship's network. And when we're in a place where we can get a network, then we can switch over to that and everybody's on 4G. This works basically like any mobile phone, but it's more complicated, and you can put multiple SIM cards in there. So the pros of 4G, clearly is the speed. It's relatively inexpensive compared to the satellite communications, and there's virtually no latency. We'll come back to that later. The cons of 4G or cellular data is the range. The range is limited, 6 to 20 miles offshore, but more like 10 miles maximum in my experience. Most normal SIM cards that you get are limited. Even when they say unlimited, they have a little asterisk next to it, and then underneath, if you look at the small print, it says fair use policy, or words to that effect. Basically meaning, if you use it, if you abuse it, they'll cut you back, even though it says unlimited. The other problem with a normal SIM card, because I get a lot of comments, oh, well, I've got unlimited on my phone. Take that to another country and see how you get on. So some SIM cards have European roaming in the European cards. Some American ones have roaming in Canada and stuff like that. But yachts go all over the world, so it doesn't really work for a superyacht unless it's just hanging out in a marina in Florida or something. Okay, the next one what we've got is Wi-Fi. So most marinas, as part of the service, they offer a Wi-Fi service. Usually included in the price, and the yachts have these systems where we can piggyback onto it and rebroadcast it through the ship on the ship's network. And this is quite popular. The speeds are relatively good. So that's the pro. The pros is that the speed is usually quite good. The cons are it's not always available, and the speeds vary at different marinas.
And of course, the range is limited, usually to that marina. Number three is shore connection. A lot of the marinas, you'll go in, you'll see these posts sticking out of the ground. They've got water connection, they've got electricity, and they've got internet. Not all of them, but a lot of the marina, the bigger marinas tend to have this. So basically we go outside, we plug an Ethernet cable in, and we run it into the ship, and then we switch over to that. This is the most preferred one by any super yacht, really, because this is where you get the speeds, the real speeds, like 100 megabits. Ooh, I nearly did it then. 100 megabits per second plus. So the pros are the speed. The cons are limited to being plugged into the network, obviously. Also, other limitation is the cable. If you run a cable length longer than 50 meters, then you're going to run into problems. So unless you can put a router in between that cable run to boost the signal, it's not going to make it any further really than 50 meters. Okay, and the last one, but the most important one, is VESA. And if you've ever wondered what those golf ball shaped things are on top of super yachts, they are for satellite communications. Inside of that dome, you have antennas, parabolic antennas on pedestals, 360 degree pedestals, and they can track satellites anywhere in the world. Unless you're in the Antarctic or the Arctic, you can get internet signals usually. They connect to satellites in geostationary orbit. So what is geostationary orbit? That basically means the satellites are about 36,000 kilometers above the Earth, aligned along the equator. So I know what you're thinking, the Earth is moving, so how does that work? Well, at this height, they move in time with the Earth, so effectively they're in the same position relative to the Earth as it rotates. The pros of VSAT, obviously, it can be used anywhere. You can use it in a marina, you can use it near a city, you can use it out at sea in the middle of the ocean. This is the only one that works. If you go any further than that, if you cross the Atlantic or you're out in the ocean, this is all you have. The cons of VSAT is the biggest con. I don't mean con, pros and cons. The biggest con is the cost. Firstly, you have to invest in antennas, right? So depending on which antennas you get, they start at around $30,000 US dollars, and they go up to over $100,000 US. There's a 3.4 meter hybrid that's available, very expensive. Hybrid in that it does two different signals. It does C-band and it does Ku-band, but I don't want to go into that too much in this video. The second problem or con with this is the speeds. So there are some providers now that offer, well, there's some providers that offer higher than this, but the big providers offer, the highest number they offer is about 100 megabits per second, which is fast by maritime standards, but by home standards now, it's not that fast, really. It's sort of average, isn't it? One of the other big problems with VSAT is the latency. I mentioned it earlier. You type in an email, you hit send, it has to travel 36,000 kilometers up to space to the satellite. Then it gets to the satellite. Then it has to travel 36,000 kilometers back down to Earth to a land Earth station, which is basically a hub on the ground, which takes all the data that comes in from that satellite and disperses it out onto the internet. So this delay is called latency. It's a bit like if you're in a thunder and lightning storm, you see the lightning and then you hear the thunder so many seconds later, and you can actually count the seconds to tell you approximately how far away that lightning is, right? Another problem with VSAT is it can be affected by the weather. So you have something called rain and cloud attenuation, or we call it rain fade. So if you have heavy rain or very heavy, thick clouds, it has to be very heavy, it can affect the connection because your antenna is pointing up into space at this satellite. And if there's the thick layer of cloud in between or heavy rain, then the signal just starts to drop out. That can be at both ends. So you might be in the Caribbean and the weather's beautiful and you've got a blue sky, but where your land Earth station is, let's say it's in Spain, if they've got heavy rain, then they can't get the signal from the satellites. So even though you're in the clear, they're not. That can be a problem. And that's why big companies like MTN Sat, they're now called Priva, they've got multiple land earth stations. So if there's got bad weather at one, they can just switch to another. And some of the smaller companies, they only have one land earth station. But I don't want to go into that too much. So firstly, the 4G systems. Usually what we do on the yacht is when we're in Europe, we'll get a SIM card from, these are special SIM cards that are just data only, and they're designed to work in the entire region. So there's probably like 50, 60 countries. So if you're in Europe, in the Mediterranean, you're basically covered in all the European Union countries. And if the same as if you're in North America or the Caribbean, you can usually get one that works in all those places. The cost per is measured per gigabyte downloaded. So the more you download, the smaller the per gigabyte cost is. But generally a yacht of say 70 to 90 meters with a crew of say 25 to 30, plus the guests and all the systems and that, they'll generally use, let's say 100 or to 160 gigabytes downloaded per month. And most of the companies, the cost of that data will be about €4.5 per gigabyte. So that works out at about €720 a month, which is a lot of money, isn't it? It's not in comparison to the Visa, but it's still a lot of money. It's not like your $30 a month unlimited plan, which is not really unlimited usually. So the Ethernet and Wi-Fi, they are often included in the berthing costs of the yacht. But not all of them do that. Some of them charge extra on top, but it's a nominal charge because it's connected to a land-based system. So they don't charge very much for that at all. So hold on to your hats now. If you look at this list here, for 10 megabits per second, you can see there that the price is, assuming you have a yearly contract, is $12,200, that's US dollars per month. This is one of the premium satellite internet providers in the yachting industry. If you see the columns, the first column tells you your MIR, or maximum information rate. This is what you'll get if there's enough free bandwidth on that beam or on that connection on the satellite. The next column tells you CIR. This is committed information rate. This is what the providers are required by contract to give you. And you can see the CIR for €12,200 per month, it's only guaranteed to be 2 megabits per second. So you're paying for 10 megabits per second, but that's only if it's available. And if you complain that you're only getting 2 megs, and they look, they'll just say, well, you're getting what's in your contract, so that's it. And let's look at the price of the 100 megabits per second. And as you can see, it's $75,600 per month. That's a lot of money. Even for a billionaire. And what most yachts do is they have let's say they have 4 megabits or 10 megabits connection. And when the owner comes on and they want more speed, they boost it for that period. Let's say the owner says he's coming on for 2 weeks. They boost the signal up to 20 megabits per second, right? So at the end of that time when he leaves, then it drops back down again automatically. Now when you get that service, that the prices are even higher. So because you're temporarily boosting your signal, it's much more expensive. You'll probably think that the owners, you know, the owners are all billionaires, they're all rich, they don't care about this stuff. The amount of money they spend on that yacht, they don't care about this. We'd be wrong. They do care. And I've had most of the owners I've worked for, they've all complained about the cost of the internet. Things that came up in my last video an awful lot in the comments, and it still comes up now, is wait till Elon Musk launches Starlink in 2020, it's all going to change. They're going to put satellites in space, many satellites, thousands of satellites, but they're not going to put them in geostationary orbit. They're going to put them in something called low Earth orbit, or LEO orbit. And that's about 600 kilometers. What's going to happen is the latency that we talked about earlier, the time it takes to go up to that geostationary satellite, will be eliminated, and you'll get speeds more like you get on land with a wired connection. The problem with that system is when you put a satellite in low Earth orbit, it's not stationary, so it's constantly moving. So as the planet's spinning, the satellite's moving like this. So you have to have many of them. The other thing is, because they're so low, the footprint that that satellite can cover is smaller. So the geostationary satellite has a massive footprint because it's so far away from the planet. It can cover, imagine you get your torch and you shine it on a football. The further away you take that, the more it covers, but the weaker it gets, right? So when you put it close, you get a stronger signal, but you don't have the coverage. So they have lots of them. And the plan is eventually is that all of these satellites will be covered, the complete globe will be covered with these satellites. And they will all communicate with each other. And so when you send a message from, say, New York, and you want to send it to London, it will go up to one satellite, and then it will be passed along a series of satellites until it reaches London. Unfortunately, the Elon Musk and his egghead scientists haven't figured out yet how to make the satellites communicate with each other effectively with the data. He has to have a land earth station for each satellite, like the traditional geostationary satellites. So what's going to happen is, even though he's going to have a series of these satellites all moving in these orbits, they can't communicate with each other. So they're all going to be sending the data down to different land earth stations. The problem for ships is, when you're out at sea in the ocean, there's going to be no land earth station. So there's probably going to be a signal for 100 miles or so off the coast, but then it's going to be like 4G, but with a better range. But then you're going to go out further and you're going to lose that signal. So until they can figure out how to make those satellites communicate with each other, then it's not a viable solution. Also, he says that by 2027, or Starlink say that by 2027, well, 7 years' time, they'll have 12,000 satellites covering the planet. But that's not enough for complete coverage. They're going to need 42,000 satellites eventually. And they currently don't even have, they haven't released a plan of when that is likely to be. So at least for 7 years, this is not going to be a solution for yachting. So Starlink will revolutionize satellite internet in the future, but it's not going to be for at least another, I would say it's probably going to be a decade before it's fully implemented. What might happen is, there might be a situation where in the Mediterranean and in North America, you have almost complete coverage of those areas at sea. So you might be able to go between those and get good coverage. There is another problem. Every vessel that's currently out there does not have any equipment on board that will communicate with this system. So that every vessel would have to go and be retrofitted with an antenna capable of transmitting and receiving to these new satellites. So that's more cost for the owner. I'm sure they won't mind that, with the promise of very high speeds with low latency, but it's going to take time for that to happen as well. So if you did try to guess what a VSAT stands for, it stands for Very Small Aperture Terminal, which means completely nothing to most of us. But anyway, there you go. So if you did get it right, well done. All right, guys. So I hope you enjoyed the video. If you've got any questions, which I'm sure you will have, in the comments. I'm sure there are going to be some Elon Musk fans correcting me on this, but this is what I know from a lot of research and a lot of communications with various different companies. So anyway, yeah, let's talk about it in the comments. Let me know what you think, and don't forget to subscribe, and I'll catch you soon. All right, guys, bye. Thank you.